So nice to be here, seeing a lot of the old familiar faces. And I'm really glad that you decided to honor my dad because I bought this red suit and there's not a lot of places you can wear it.
This is one.
So as I read the nomination form and supporting letters for my dad to get this honor tonight, a lot of nice words stuck out. Dedicated, knowledgeable, mentor, respected, Mr. Wheat. These are some of the words his peers use when they speak of the retired wheat producer, Frank Johannson. I call him Dad. And man of steel, sometimes, but more on that later. Born in humble beginnings, he's a native of the Baird area in western Nebraska and still lives on the dryland wheat farm that his father started in an area known as Good Street. And the name is explained in the program, that's why it's called Good Street. His formal education was cut short when he contracted polio when he was 18, but he never let that hold him back. Well, now that he's almost 90, maybe a little. After several months in the hospital back in 1944 and 45, he gradually recovered and rejoined his father in a custom wheat harvesting operation that would take them from Texas to Montana every summer. This was even before self-propelled combines, as in horse-drawn combines. Although he and my grandpa did get two of International Harvester's first models when they did come out. So he went from that to many years later, traveling the world to market U.S.-grown wheat to other countries, successfully finding new customers for American farmers to sell their products to, especially in Southeast Asia. After marrying my mom, Judy, in 1947, the two moved to the family farm full-time in 1949, to take over the day-to-day operations, while his dad and Uncle Herman and his brother Charles, who's here with us tonight, continued on the custom harvesting trips. My dad has said that a casual conversation with a county extension agent after World War II about how farmers would need to increase production in order to feed the world really stuck with him and started him on his path of improving and promoting his industry. My dad was one of the founding members of the Nebraska Wheat Growers Association in the 1950s, and the group was instrumental in getting the Wheat Checkoff Program established in 1955. This was the first commodity checkoff program in Nebraska, and only the second wheat checkoff in the nation. The funds collected from each bushel of wheat sold in Nebraska are used to promote wheat products by investing in research, international and domestic marketing, policy development, publicity, and education. It started out as a quarter cent, one-fourth of a penny per bushel, and the program continues today to where the Nebraska Wheat Board now presides over $1 million-plus budget. My dad would go on to be the Nebraska Wheat Growers Man of the Year in 1969, state president in 1975, and National Wheat Growers President in 1988, or as I called it, the Grand Poobah of Wheat. He started out locally serving as president of the Morrill County Extension Board. We have that former Morrill County Extension agent with us tonight, Ben Holliday, glad he's connected. And he was the director of the North Platte Natural Resources District. At the state level, he's been involved with and held leadership positions for the Gasohol Board, now known as the Ethanol Board, the Nebraska Cooperative Extension Advisory Council, and the Nebraska Ag Council. He also served several years on the Agricultural Stabilization and Conservation Service Committee, the ASCS, and 6 years as State Director of the Nebraska Association of Farmer Elected Committeemen. When it became apparent that American farmers needed a bigger market in which to sell their wheat, he helped to organize and lead the market developing organizations of Great Plains Wheat and Western Wheat Associates, which later merged to form U.S. Wheat Associates. My dad made a number of overseas trips to visit the group's marketing offices and meet with customers in places like Thailand, China, the Philippines, and New Zealand. I can remember because he brought me back t-shirts for most of them. My dad has said that he found it helpful to both buyers and sellers to get out into the country and talk with people. He has one story from a trip to Hong Kong in which he had to advise a baker how to keep sesame seeds on hamburger buns in a newly established McDonald's restaurant there. Whatever it takes, right? And when cost and labor problems emerged in the early 1970s with railroads and grain elevators and the big shipping ports that prevented the farmers from exporting their wheat to these new customers, my dad got involved to find a solution. As transportation chairman for the National Wheat Growers, he would try to negotiate solutions. Sometimes he literally had to get the opposing sides to sit down together to discuss their problems. Nothing like talking face to face over a good meal in a relaxed atmosphere, as he put. International visitors were always welcome to visit the Johansson family farm, and Manny got their first perspective on the American wheat fallow system there. He also worked closely with the Panhandle Research and Extension Center in Scottsbluff, and hello to everybody who's here from there, providing land and support for research and demonstrations. In recognition of his efforts to help the university research staff to identify a wheat adapted to our part of the state, the variety Goodstreet was released by UNL in 2002. It was during his time as the state director of the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Consolidated Farm Service Agency from 1993 to 1996 that Dad faced one of his biggest personal challenges. He hadn't been in the position long after President Clinton's first appointed director passed away only after 3 months on the job. He and Mom had come home one weekend from Lincoln to farm, and he was injured when the tractor he was standing next to jumped into gear, trapping his foot and running over him the length of his whole left side from foot to shoulder. He saved himself by wiggling just enough to get his head out of the way of the big wheel of the tractor, and luckily the ground was a little soft and had some give. I shake my head when I think about it. So after regaining his wits and bleeding a little bit from some cuts, he managed to walk about a quarter of a mile back to the house, where my very shocked mother drove him the 27 miles to the nearest hospital. Taking his job responsibilities very seriously and conscious of the fact that the previous director had just died not that long ago, my dad asked Mom to return to Lincoln alone to personally assure the FSA staff that he would be okay and back in the job as soon as possible. He thought if they saw her in person, that they would figure he wasn't in that bad shape. He was. That was a long drive for my mom to make, worried as she was about her husband that she did. And with the same will he used to recover from polio 50 years earlier, he did indeed resume his duties. My mom was a lifelong partner with Dad in promoting wheat and the ag industry, and they were honored not only separately by various organizations, but also together as the Nebraska Kiwanis Club's first Farm Family Award in 1984, the Outstanding Contributions to Agriculture Award from the Panhandle Research Center in 1988, the Nebraska Agribusiness Club Service to Agricultural Award in 1990, and by the Nebraska Ag Relations Council in 2003. Speaking of my mom being involved with him, and I see that we have a husband and wife team being honored tonight, and I couldn't help but notice that there are very few women in your hall of agriculture. He lost my mom in 2009, and he has since sold his 800 acres to my older brother Dallas, Scottsbluff. The land is now in the Conservation Reserve Program. But Dad continues to live on the farm and has been his home for nearly 60 years. We've tried to get him to move, believe me, but he won't go. I am proud to present this year's honoree for the Nebraska Hall of Agricultural Achievement and my personal superhero, Frank Johansson. Thank you.
Sure.
You wanna say anything, like, say something?
I don't think that those are the things that were in my mind at the time when I became involved to try and help agriculture survive in a pretty hazardous world. It took a lot of effort and a lot of different organizations to keep things going for agriculture. Washington, D.C., transportation, all kinds of issues pop up for farmers, it seems like. And we felt like there should be a group of people who would attempt to do something, and I think we were quite successful in a lot of our efforts of helping to develop new varieties of grain. Charlie Prinster used to come out to my farm all the time and put in test plots and everything like that. Finally, he moved to test plot. He was great to work with. I'm sorry he isn't here tonight. And he and I were good friends to the very end, as well as a number of people here who I became acquainted with. Roger is one of them. I don't know how many years we've known each other.
A long time.
But a long time. But I think we were successful in keeping agriculture going. We worked with the U.S. Department of Agriculture to get the money to develop a lot of the research money that needed to be developed and such as that. Tried to do what needed to be done, and I felt like we were pretty much successful.
I would say so too.